Hey, welcome back, folks. Chris Garlock here once again with Michael Redmond, 9-9 professional for our AlphaGo against the world. World not doing so well, some 40-some games. But we're having a lot of fun, and I'm sure they were as well. Today, Michael, I think what we could fairly call a frequent flyer, right?
Yes, Park Junghwan. Fifth game in the series.
Fifth game. Did anybody else play that many games?
I think Wen Tailing, the Chinese player, he played, well, five games.
Your favorites.
Kind of a caveat about his final game, which was once he collaborated with someone else, he played a pair goal sort of game.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, Wen Tailing did play five games, so that is the same. And you're going to recognize the opening. That's the interesting part of this game, is that you get to guess when you saw it before. You probably won't be able to get into the game. He's going to play an opening that is the same as someone else tried, and he's going to differ at move 25. So up to move 24, it's going to be the same.
Uh-oh. I did not know there was going to be a test today. All right, I'll try to pay more attention than usual.
Park Junghwan has the black stones.
Okay.
It's far in the past for you. It's about 20 games, more than 20 games ago.
Oh, good lord.
Black is going to try but you're going to recognize the shape because it's something that I got excited about. Black plays the Chinese opening.
Yeah.
And this actually was a fairly common opening with black sometimes covering here immediately, sometimes playing away to one of these corners, one of these two moves, and a combination of that. And this was very popular. I think there was an AlphaGo versus AlphaGo game that was specially shown to us, and AlphaGo was playing this kind of opening in those games. And so this whole combination, black is various orders of moves have been played with the covering here later sometimes, or playing these kakaris later. But the whole pattern here was very popular at the time. It was one of the popular openings that they had. And then black would play here. Obviously not where computer programs would want to play now.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, now computer programs would probably be suggesting one of these attachments against the corner. Probably something like that. But it's okay. It's not as if black really made a big mistake here. Black plays the extension to the side. White plays here. Black plays here. Okay. Do you remember where white plays the next move? It's the same pattern as you've seen before.
I think it's just the stand up, right?
No.
No.
If white plays, let's just make a variation. If white plays here, black's going to cut. Locally, the fight is not working for white. If white...
Oh, this is the C18, isn't it?
C18 doesn't really make sense to me.
Okay, I was looking for a trick move here. Oh.
You recognize this one?
Yes, of course.
And this is where I was saying that it reminded me of Honinbo Dosaku. Mm. And actually, I think for the AGA YouTube channel, I did make a video that was showing a similar game, a similar shape in the upper left there that was played by Dosaku.
Mm-hmm.
And that was in a two-stone handicap game, I think. And in this game, Park Junghwan, he plays this move. And it's been a few days because it was, it was game number 22.
Okay.
Against Chen Yaoye, in which black played this move. So it makes sense for me to believe that Park Junghwan must have researched that game,
mm-hmm,
and came up with this variation. Like I was telling you in game 22, black could have pushed through here and the third move. And this would actually have been a reasonable result for black, with black switching, taking the initiative. I made this variation in my commentary for game 22 to show how black can take sente in the upper side and take the initiative to take the first move on the left, lower left. And in this game, the lower left is like, it's the last really big opening points. If you can have opening points that are sort of A-class that are bigger than usual. And the lower left is like that. It's a more important than, for instance, the left side in general or the right side in general. The lower left corner is a more important opening area. Mm-hmm. And the mistake that Black made in game 22 was that White got to play in the lower left corner and the left side earlier and started taking an advantage at that point. But actually, in this variation where Black pushes through at e16, Black can, just because the next move on the upper side is so big, it gives Black an opportunity to move to lower left. So this was the answer I was giving them. Park Junghwan is going to had a different idea. He plays a different hane. Obviously, in this position, the two moves that you sort of want to think of are this hane or this hane. Black, since Black has a local advantage, so many black stones in the area, Black does want to try to play actively here, which indicates a hane rather than pulling back. This would be the other move that Black could play, but there's the feeling that it's a bit submissive mm-hmm. when Black has a local advantage here. Black does sort of want to play actively. So Black plays here and plays a double hane. And White cuts. This the whole thing here makes sense. Actually, White seems to be taking a slight advantage here. So I'll go back and say that Black should have gotten to this variation that I'm suggesting just now. In this variation, when White covers here, Katago says that White has a very slight advantage, like 52% for White or something like that. And again, that's an advantage that wouldn't bother me in a human game, unless someone told me about it. Like, I wouldn't know. And here is where Black could have curled around, in which case White will squeeze like this. I think something like this could be expected. And it's playable for White, but maybe better for Black than the game. Like something like this. You can see Black is taking a lot of territory in this variation. And I sort of like it for Black. Although already White has a slight advantage, according to Katago, this is a variation that if I was playing with Black, I would feel that I had a good potential just with all this territory that Black is getting on the upper side. Yeah. And the fact that 16 and 17 on the left there, those two points were mi-ai. And so White has to get a very good attack in this area on the left side in order to make this work. So I would have the feeling that it's playable for Black. I would like this variation for Black. In the game, Black extended here. This is going to allow White to cover here. And after White, like if White had backed off like this, then it would be perfectly okay for Black to be curling around. Black would be playing on both sides. This would be good for Black. But when White covers here, Black has to cut. And so it's going to get a bit tactically complicated.
Yeah, it is.
White plays a hane here. Pretty obvious that Black doesn't really want to play here. This would just be faster for Black. So Black plays down. This is forced. White extends. This is forced too. Like if White covers here, Black can live in the corner and this would be a collapse for White. So this is forced too. Black has to curl around. In the game, he chose to cut here first. And there was some discussion about this move because it's arguable that Black should have played here first. And it's really a very fine point that's very hard for me to call even now. And so I'm going to ignore it for the purpose of this video.
Okay.
In the game, he played here. And the idea is that if White connects now here and allows Black to squeeze this way, this is something that White wants to think about because connecting to this marked stone here, this stone is a cutting stone. So it's something that White would really like to do. But when White does this, it's going to allow Black to capture the two stones on the left. Mm. The fact that Black got a forcing move here, makes it possible for Black to play the double hane here and capture those stones on the left. Just the fact that there's no longer any double atari here, that the fact that Black got that stone at four makes a big difference. So that's the idea behind this squeeze here. And the fact that Black managed to capture this stone is going to reinforce Black a lot. This whole position here is completely reinforced. So that's the pro, that's the positive result that black got. And the negative result is that white's group in the corner is now pretty much 100% alive. It's alive now. And so the fact that black played that squeeze made it just slightly more easy for white to get a living shape there. So that's the negative aspect. Black curls around, white jumps. So at this point, a white move here in the corner would give white locally a living shape. And if white extends here, usually that's going to be a forcing move. So white's going to have two eyes, one at D19 and one at F19 at the very least. So white has two directions to go and to make two eyes. So that group can be called alive. And in the game, black extended here. Now, the sequence here is sort of very unfortunate for black, because black starts off with this slow move, which was not making white heavy enough. Black should have played an Atari here.
Just been trying to read that out. I just tried to see why.
The idea is to shut up the attack on these two stones.
Right.
Make it more difficult for white to sacrifice them. And white will play here and maybe connect in this case. It's just going to give that much more momentum to black. In this variation, it's going to be more difficult for white to sacrifice these stones just because they've increased in number.
Uh-huh.
And so white will play something like that. You can see white's connection there is a bit flimsy. And black can play 11. That's going to make a living shape, forcing white to live on the side. So white's alive with two eyes, but black is also alive on the left side. And white's shape is not so good there. Like it's going to be connected, but it is an eyeless shape. So in this whole fight on the left side, although that black stone in the lower left corner, it does look a bit lonely. White has a very bad shape too. So there's potential for black to do some attacking here. So this would actually be fairly playable, would still be very close to 50%. But instead, black plays, black plays this move. It's just not putting enough pressure on these two stones. So black played a move that was not putting enough pressure on white. That was black's first mistake here. It reduced black's winning percentage. Now, white plays an Atari and lives in the corner. Okay?
Oh, really?
So now black's going to play here to try to put pressure on white. So he tried to put pressure on white here. He should have done it here. Now when he tries to put pressure on white, it's going to back. When he plays here to try to put pressure on white, it's going to backfire. So actually, he should have just simply taken the two stones. White's not going to save those two stones. White's going to play something on the side. Something like this could happen. This would have been relatively okay for black. It would have been, it's still probably close to 60% for white. So it's not good for black, but it's a lot better than the game. When black plays here, trying to put pressure on white, it backfired because when white plays here, those black stones there in the corner, they're in danger of being killed.
That's what I've been trying to work out, because it just seems like white has got all kinds of threats on those stones. I'm really worried about them.
So it's sort of annoying for black, because at this point he could have played very actively and strongly, and it would have worked. He tries it too late. And so sort of realizing his mistake, he tries to play forcefully, but it's too late now. I think he was just seeing his mistake, but he should have just taken the two stones like this. In the game, he pincers, white bumps against. Black has to go back to the two stones, and you can see white's getting this very nice shape on the left side. So this is, locally, it's just a nice shape for white. And the game continued. At this point, it's more like, 35% for black, that's 65% for white. And it's already close before Komi. So maybe black can win by 1 point on the board. And they got into this. It's just, after this, it's still a game that was pretty interesting up to the end of the game. And it was one of the games, I think it became fairly close. Let's see, this was game 48. And it ended up 1.5 points for white. So it did end up being a close game, but it's just the same story of white giving some of the points back at the end of the game.
Mm-hmm. And I think one of the lessons of that too for folks, and another reason why it's gonna be really interesting in the book as we look, you know, again, for this series, we really just wanted to focus on some of the key points, keep the video short. But in the game commentaries, you know, when you've got two humans playing, you know, we make all kinds of, I don't know if I want to call them mistakes, but maybe a slow move or not an optimal move. So there's lots of opportunities to recover from those kinds of moves or to take advantage of one of those kind of moves that your opponent makes. So there's, Even after watching these videos, there's going to be still lots to learn from the commentaries, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, my take in this game was just that the what happened there in the upper left, I think sometimes there's some emotion involved in a choice, and sometimes it's just your assessment of the overall position in which you realize that you're behind and you try to do something extra. And it's not the same, like it's not the way that the computer programs play it. They play the best move anyway. And so it's sort of interesting for me to see that difference between the human players and the computer in this game.
We do get emotional. We get attached to things, our ideas, our moves, and so forth. All right, Michael, thank you. Thanks, everybody, for watching, and we will see you next time.